Small Gods by Terry Pratchett. Read by Tony Robinson. Now consider the tortoise and the eagle. The tortoise is a ground-living creature. Its horizons are a few inches away. It has survived by being, on the whole, no threat to anyone and too much trouble to eat. And then there is the eagle, a creature of the air and high places, lightning death on wings, talons and claws enough to make a meal of anything smaller than it is. And yet the eagle will sit for hours on the crag until it spots a distant movement, and then it will focus, focus, focus on the small shell wobbling down there on the desert, and it will leap. And the tortoise finds the world dropping away from it, and it sees the world for the first time, and it thinks, "What a great friend I have in the eagle." And then the eagle lets go. The story takes place in desert lands. When it begins and ends is more problematical. History has to be controlled. Things have to happen at the right time. So history has its caretakers. They live in a hidden valley in the high ramtops of the Discworld, where the books of history are kept. These are the books from which history is derived. There are more than 20,000 of them. Each one is 10 feet high and bound in lead. When people say, "It is written," it is written here. The 493rd abbot folded his wrinkled hands and addressed Lutze, one of the most senior monks. "The place is Omnia," he said, "on the Latian coast."
"I remember," said Lutze. "Dry place. Haven't been to Omnia for, must be 700 years.
Off you go, then."
"I shall take my mountains," said Lutze. "The climate will be good for them."
It was the year of the notional serpent, which meant that the time of the eighth prophet was imminent. And it came to pass that in that time the great god Om spake unto Baratha, the chosen one.
Psht!
Baratha paused in mid-ho and stared around the temple garden.
"Pardon?"
It was a fine day early in the lesser spring. Bees loafed around in the bean blossoms, but buzzed fast in order to give the impression of hard work. High above, a lone eagle circled. And at the far end of the garden, old brother Lutze was dreamily forking over the dung heap. Baratha shrugged and got back to the melons. Yea, the great god Om spake again.
Psst!
Baratha hesitated. Perhaps it was a demon. The thing to do was to be resolute and repeat the 9 fundamental aphorisms. Once more, the great god Om spake unto Baratha.
"Are you deaf, boy?"
The hoe thudded onto the baking soil.
"Get thee behind me, demon."
"I am behind you."
Baratha turned again slowly. The garden was still empty. The third thing people noticed about Vorbis was his height. He was well over 6 feet tall, but stick thin. The second thing that people noticed about Vorbis was his eyes, not just dark of pupil, but almost black of eyeball. It was as if he had sunglasses on under his skin. But the first thing they noticed was his skull. Most of the church's ministers cultivated long hair and beards that you could lose a goat in, but Deacon Vorbis was bald by design. He shaved all over, he gleamed, and lack of hair seemed to add to his power. He didn't menace, he never threatened, for Vorbis was the head of the Quisition, and he knew his destiny. Hadn't the god himself told him? He didn't often go down to watch the inquisitors at work. Exquisitors didn't have to. He sent down instructions. He received reports. But special circumstances merited his special attention. Currently, he was sitting alongside the bench on which lay what was still technically the trembling body of Brother Sasho, formerly his secretary. He leant over.
What were their names?
Don't know.
Sasho, they are treacherous heretics.
Don't know names.
I trusted you, Sasho. You betrayed the church.
No names.
Truth is surcease from pain, Sasho.
Truth.
Yes.
Sasho opened his one remaining eye.
Truth.
Yes.
The turtle moves.
Brother picked up his hoe and turned back to the vines. The blade was about to hit the ground when he saw the tortoise. It was small and basically yellow and covered with dust. Its shell was badly chipped. It had one beady eye. Baratha looked around. The gardens were well inside the temple complex and surrounded by high walls.
How did you get in here, little creature? He said. Did you fly?
The tortoise stared monoptically at him.
I don't think tortoises are allowed in the gardens. Aren't you vermin?
The tortoise continued to stare.
How would you like a grape, little tortoise?
How would you like to be an abomination in the nethermost pit of chaos?
Said the tortoise. Eventually, Baratha opened his eyes and took his fingers out of his ears.
I'm still here.
It dawned on Baratha very slowly that demons and succubi didn't turn up looking like small old tortoises.
I didn't know tortoises could talk, he said.
They can't. Read my lips.
Baratha looked closer.
You haven't got lips.
No. I'm doing it straight into your head, and I don't have to waste time on gardeners. Go and fetch the top man right now.
Top man?
The high priest, or whatever he calls himself. I suppose there is one.
Baratha nodded blankly.
High priest, right? High priest?
I can't go asking the...
Baratha hesitated. Even the thought of talking to the Cenobiarch frightened him.
I can't ask anyone to ask the High Cenobiarch to talk to a tortoise.
Turn into a mudleech and wither in the fires of retribution!
The tortoise bounced up and down furiously.
There's no need to curse.
That wasn't a curse. That was an order. I am the great god Om!
Baratha blinked.
No, you're not. I've seen the great god Om. He comes as an eagle, or a lion, or a mighty bull. There's a statue in the great temple. It's got horns of real gold.
I am the great god Om,
said the tortoise, in a menacing and unavoidably low voice.
And before very long, you are going to be a very unfortunate priest.
Novice.
What?
Novice, not priest.
Get him! Fetch him now, or the moon will be as blood, and agues and boils will afflict mankind!
I'll see what I can do,
said Baratha, backing away. His grubby robe disappeared through the gateway. Vorbis's room was in the upper citadel, which was unusual for a mere deacon. He hadn't asked for it. He seldom had to ask for anything. He also got visited by some of the most powerful men in the church's hierarchy. Not, of course, the six archpriests or the Cenobiarch himself. They were merely at the top. The people who really run organisations are usually found several levels down. Two of them were with him now. They were General Iron Friot, who ran the Divine Legion, and Bishop Daruna, secretary to the Congress of Iams.
And now, Vorbis said, the matter of Ephebi, after what they did to poor Brother Murdoch. The insults to Om. This must not pass. What is proposed?
No more fighting, said Fright. We've lost too many already. They fight like madmen. They have strong gods, said Daruna.
There is no god but Om, said Vorbis. Have you seen this?
He pushed forward a scroll of paper.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.